when it first appeared at the airfield, it raised a storm of emotions. The aircraft design was different to any other that existed at the time. It looked like it came from the future. Because of its nose shape and the very long fuselage, the LA-250 was given its name Anaconda. It was to become the first in its class of long-range, all-weather, supersonic missile-carrying interceptors, a machine that was even hard to imagine in those days. It was 1953. Only 2 years have passed since the first aircraft in the USSR managed to reach the speed of sound. That was also the merit of the LA-250 chief designer Semyon Lavochkin. He was creating airplanes at the dawn of Soviet aviation and during the Second World War, realizing the most daring ideas, many of which were ahead of time. The LA-250 was the first aircraft in Soviet aviation to use extensive interception process automation in interaction with ground guidance systems, which soon became a requirement in air defense. The LA-250 was not regarded as a single aircraft, rather it was an air defense complex, as both the airplane and missiles were to be designed. This was the first and only aircraft in the USSR with purely missile weapons. Its main objective was to intercept airplanes and cruise missiles from their alert position. It was the largest and heaviest aircraft produced by the Lavochkin Design Bureau. It also became the last one. After the LA-250, the Design Bureau no longer produced airplanes. So, let's go deep into this topic. It was 1949. The Cold War between the Soviet Union and the United States was already underway. The arms race had begun. Both the US and the USSR were extensively using jet engines in aviation. Soviet machines did a great step forward, but still remained subsonic. Lavochkin appealed to Stalin with a proposal to create a supersonic plane. Thus, the work on the Project 190 had begun. In 1951, during the flight tests, the aircraft was able to reach the speed of 1,190 km per hour, making the LA-190 the first aircraft in the USSR to exceed the speed of sound. Lavochkin was developing his ideas in the Project 200, but Yakovlev's YAK-25 went into serial production. When in 1954 the YAK-25 was produced, it had quite a high flight data, but still remained subsonic. Considering that the US and the UK had already been engaged in the development of supersonic bombers and cruise missiles, a completely different approach was needed. The task was complicated by the fact that the large territory of the USSR required the use of long-range aviation. The range of a new aircraft was to be at least 1,800 km, and the most difficult requirement was that its speed was to be at least Mach 1.5. In June 1953, the Lavochkin Design Bureau prepared a technical proposal for the creation of the K-15 interception system. When it was approved by the government, the work had begun. To imagine how ambitious this project was, it's enough to take a look at what it included. It was planned to develop the LA-250 rocket-carrying interceptor, the K-15U onboard radar detection and guidance system, the radar target identification system on Alien, the onboard receiving equipment for intercept targeting linked to ground target detection and interceptor guidance system, the guided missiles 275 with radar guidance system. The development required considerable resources, including time. On August 13, 1954, the Chief of General Staff, the First Deputy Commander of the Air Force Rudenko, and the Minister of Aviation Industry of the USSR Khrunichev, not to be confused with Khrushchev, in a report to the Council of Ministers of the USSR, indicated a delay in the development of interception system, although the development lasted no more than a year. Since the officials were trying to expedite the project, the problems appeared right away. The development of the VK-9 engine, which was to be installed on the plane, was curtailed. Since there was no engine of such power in the USSR, the designers had to install the AL-7F engine with much less traction. The replacement of propulsion system caused the changes in the whole aircraft. The fuselage became smaller. The wings were changed from flechette to triangular. The K-15U radio side, which was still in development, was replaced with an already existing K-15M with worse parameters. In early 1956, an entirely new aircraft was presented to the officials of the Ministry of Aviation Industry and the Air Force. Its performance deteriorated, but remained very high for the time. It became lighter, with maximum takeoff weight of 27,500 kilos. The maximum speed without suspended missiles was 1,700 to 1,800 kilometers per hour. And with suspended missiles at an altitude of 12 kilometers, the maximum speed equaled 1,600 kilometers per hour. The surface ceiling of the aircraft was 17,000 meters. The LA-250 could intercept targets flying at an altitude of up to 19,500 meters at a speed of up to 1,200 kilometers per hour. The unusual appearance of the aircraft was justified by its technical requirements. The significant length of the fuselage was due to the fact that it contained fuel tanks. They provided a long endurance and a range of 2,000 kilometers. The designers decided to use side air intakes on the airplane, although they had not been sufficiently explored back then. Due to their use, the antenna of a large diameter radar side was placed in the bow. The radar equipment of the K-15 complex had large dimensions and weighed 750 kilos. This was the reason of an unusual nose shape of the aircraft. The radar provided long range for target detection. The cockpit equipped with ejection seats had tandem layout. A pilot and a navigator were placed one after another. Under the wings, it would carry four 600 kilos K-15 rockets. Solid aluminum alloys as well as stainless steel were widely used in the design, but the main materials remained alloy steels and duralumin. Together with Lavochkin, the leading designer Naum Chernikov participated in the development of the LA-250, and I would like to dwell on him in detail. He started his aviation career with the design and construction of the trolley bus, MTV-82. It's hard to say what kind of trolley bus it was, but after that, under the leadership of Lavochkin, Chernikov is one of the main designers participated in the creation of S-25 Burkett Air Defense Complex and the world's first ground-to-ground strategic missile system named Buria. Definitely, there was something wrong with the trolley bus. In addition, after the death of Lavochkin while working for the Sukhoi Design Bureau, Chernikov was the chief designer of another legendary aircraft named the T-4. If you'd like to find out what was the fate of the Soviet Valkyrie, the video is available on the channel. The initial flight occurred on the 16th of July 1956 and ended with an accident. The aircraft had a significant roll to the right. To study the problems of sustainability, the first electronic simulation stand was created in the USSR. Control and flight systems of the aircraft were successfully tested. Later on, such testing became mandatory for all prototypes of aircraft in the USSR. The second flight went smoothly, but when the plane was landing, an accident happened again. Due to industrial haste, the pilot was unable to see the start of the runway. The aircraft was repaired and its nose was lowered by 6 degrees to improve visibility. There were also problems with the chassis, but the testing continued. As for the number of flights, the information is slightly different. According to some sources, there was one flight in 1956, six in 1957, and 14 in 1958. The other sources claim that 16 more flights were carried out in 1959. The same mix-up happened with the number of airplanes which were produced. Some sources say 4 machines were created. According to the other information, their number was 6. Manufacturing of the production model was scheduled for 1960. However, in the first half of 1958, Commander-in-Chief of the Soviet Air Force, Vershinin, in his report to the Council of Ministers of the USSR, noted that the pace of work on the LA-250 aircraft was significantly delayed by the fault of the Lavochkin Design Bureau, since the work on the project had begun in 1953. It was also noted that the LA-250 flight data was beginning to become obsolete. In July 1959, the work on the plane and the entire K-15 interception program was stopped. The report seemed definitive, but it wasn't. The LA-250 was replaced by the Tu-128 interceptor, which incorporated many developments of the Lavochkin Design Bureau. Work on the Tu-128 began in 1959, and its operational began in 1965, but its deadlines were not exceeded. Furthermore, the analysis showed that the Tu-128 and the LA-250 had roughly the same characteristics in 1960. It would be fair to admit that the Tu-128 is also a unique machine of its kind. This story could have continued, but on the 9th of June 1960, Semyon Lavochkin died of the consequences of acute heart failure at the Sharysha gun training ground during the air defense system DAL testing. The LA-250 was his last plane. After his death, the Lavochkin Design Bureau no longer produced airplanes and was redirected for space-related programs. In 1956, Khrunichev, who then occupied the post of deputy chairman at the Council of Ministers of the USSR, was removed from the office and transferred to a subordinate position with a statement that he was not serious about his responsibilities when creating air-to-air systems. Chernikov was transferred to the Sukhoi Design Bureau and was the chief designer of the T-4 strategic bomber. Unfortunately, this time he was unlucky again. His second unique aircraft could not become serial. The LA-250 stood out against the other aircrafts, even though the appearance of warplanes was changing rapidly in those years. It was the largest, fastest, and most unusual plane of its time.